Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the May meeting and program of the San Fernando Valley Unit of the Los Angeles League of Women Voters of Greater Los Angeles. I'm Joyce Batten, chair of our unit. We're very glad to have all of you here with us today, and I'm assuming that some of you in our audience may be new to the league. So in just a few words, I'd like to introduce you to who we are and what we do. Our organization dates back over 100 years when the 19th Amendment to the Constitution was ratified and women won the right to vote. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization. We encourage informed and active participation in government. We work to increase understanding of major public policy issues and influence public policy through education and advocacy. That's who we are and what we do. And I'd now like to introduce you to our program chair, Jean Thompson, who will introduce you to our speaker. Jean?
Okay. We are delighted to have someone a little different from what you have been seeing every day on TV. Partisan arguments from one side and another, disasters from criminals, or disasters of the weather. We are delighted to introduce someone born in Florida who earned several degrees in Alabama and Michigan, worked in important civic organizations, Illinois, Atlanta, Florida, visited libraries and archives in Sicily and the Aeolian Islands, now chose to bring his great talent to Los Angeles. He has been a local American librarian, library executive, 20th century librarian, and is now our chief executive, city librarian of the Los Angeles Public Library. I am going to have to give up some of my awards and all that information, just so you have time to hear him. Leading one of the world's largest libraries, Mr. Szabo will discuss the creative and innovative ways the Los Angeles Public Library serves the city. He'll give us an overview of our libraries, many of our innovative programs, and some comments about the national trends around book challenges and book bangs. So I am honored to introduce Mr. John Szabo.
Thank you so much, Jean, and many thanks to the League of Women Voters. It's a pleasure to be with you today to speak about the Los Angeles Public Library, public libraries today, and as Jean mentioned, some of the many very forward-thinking, creative ways in which public libraries are serving here in Los Angeles, our residents, but also these things that our public libraries are doing across the nation. And also want to touch on this national trend that you may have read about or seen coverage of on television of book challenges, book bans, and this issue that public libraries and small communities and mid-sized communities and even large communities across the nation are dealing with. Let me go to my PowerPoint presentation I have for you today, and go ahead and begin. In my presentation today, I do want to talk a little bit about the Los Angeles Public Library, provide you some background on the library. I hope all of you are familiar with our library, some of our services that you may have visited, one of our 73 locations. A little bit about the city that we serve. We are the public library that serves the city of Los Angeles. And then I'd like to speak about sort of our expansive approach to literacy for all ages and really being a lifelong learning institution. There are just innumerable programs and services that we provide. And I can guarantee you that you will learn something about what the Los Angeles Public Library does today that you didn't know before. And our objective in all of this is to meet the many diverse needs of LA residents. It's an exciting time in public libraries. You know, many people, I think, think that there is a battle between libraries and technology, when in fact libraries have always been incredibly nimble and have adapted to new technologies and found ways to use technology to actually make our services better, help people provide the information, help us provide people with the information that they need, and to be able to help bridge the digital divide and provide people with access to the internet and books and information and so forth. So I think our libraries are more dynamic than ever. I think they're more relevant than ever. And it's really an incredibly exciting time to be a librarian and to be providing services. And I think that's true in all types of libraries, but I certainly think that is true here in public libraries, and particularly at the LA Public Library. A little bit about the LA Public Library. We are the public library that serves the city of Los Angeles. So from the San Fernando Valley down to the Port of LA, from Pacific Palisades to El Sereno and Northeast LA, that is our service area. Now, that said, anyone in the state of California can get a library card at the LA Public Library and make use of our services. There are some online digital services that we provide that are just available for LA area residents. We actually serve the largest population of any public library in the United States. And you may say, well, we're the second largest city. How is that possible? New York is served by three wonderful public libraries: the New York Public Library, the Queensborough Public Library, and the Brooklyn Public Library. So they're sort of divided. So as a result, we do serve the largest population. The LA County Library, a wonderful library system that serves much of LA County, the unincorporated areas, as well as I think over 60 municipalities of the 88 that are in LA County. They're a very large system. They serve about 3.8 million residents, and we're at about 4.1 million residents here in the city. And they serve, of course, a much larger geography even than we do. Our library covers 503 square miles. We do that through the magnificent Central Library in downtown Los Angeles, which is where I am now. I'm in my office here at Central Library. If any of you have not been to Central Library, please come. It is one of the most beautiful libraries in the world. It is a landmark in LA. It was built in 1926. Just in a couple of years, we're going to celebrate the 100th birthday of the LA Central Library. Also important to note, the Los Angeles Public Library as an institution has been around since 1872. So we recently celebrated 150 years as an institution. And there aren't many things in LA that have been around for 150 years, and we're mighty proud of that. And I think that is because of the way in which we have changed and adapted and provided what is, I think, an essential service to the people of LA all of these years. Our budget is just under $250 million in the current fiscal year. We have over 1,600 staff members. That's full-time, part-time, and intermittent staff members that help us staff those 73 libraries, Central Library and 72 branches, for 7 days a week. So all of our libraries are open 6 days a week, and then we have 10 libraries that are open 7 days a week that have Sunday service, and those are in various areas of the city. So this is a wonderful map of the LA Public Library, and you see that is the city of LA. You see there's some pockets there of gray. It's Santa Monica and Beverly Hills and West Hollywood there in the center, and of course the city of San Fernando up in the San Fernando Valley is sort of an island municipality within the San Fernando Valley. We divide our branch libraries into six different regions. Each of them have an area manager, so they are over 12 or 13 libraries. And in the San Fernando Valley, we have the East Valley and the West Valley, and then the orange is our western area, the yellow there, golden color is the Hollywood area, central part of the city, northeast, Boyle Heights downtown, northeast LA is in purple, and then green is South LA, which goes all the way down to the Port of LA, where we have the San Pedro branch, Harbor City, Harbor Gateway, as well as the Wilmington branch library. But this gives you an idea of the geographic spread of the library system. We, of course, serve a very diverse city. As you probably know, Angelenos come from all over the world. It's one of the world's most, certainly the nation, but one of the world's most diverse cities. Angelenos come from 130 different nations, speak 224 different languages. Our library makes every effort to serve all of those folks. We have materials in our collections in about 70 to 80 different languages. We actively collect in about 14 languages. So the most spoken languages in LA, we do collect in, and we also endeavor to have staff that speak those languages in the neighborhoods and communities where those populations are predominant. So 39.7% of the population here in the city is foreign born. Languages spoken, you see English, Spanish, Asian Pacific Islander languages, other Indo-European languages, and then other languages. So language access and making certain that we are providing programming, staffing, collections, and even communications and promotion, marketing, and PR in the languages that Angelenos speak is incredibly important. One of the things that is so fortunate about the LA Public Library, and this is true for libraries generally, is that we have tremendous community support, just great philanthropic support as well. So volunteerism is huge with our library. We have thousands of volunteers. We have the Library Foundation of Los Angeles, which is a nonprofit that seeks grants, seeks individual funding, corporate funding, foundation funding for major projects of the library that are system-wide, as well as projects that benefit specific branches and areas of central library, collections, children's programming, teen programming, and we're very, very lucky to have them. We also have 70 different Friends of the Library groups, and these Friends groups support various branch libraries. So there's a Friends of the Sherman Oaks Library, a Friends of the Sylmar Library, and then also Friends of the Photo Collection here at Central Library, which is one of the largest photo collections in the Western US. So we're very, very fortunate to have all of this external support of the library. And it makes us really rather unique as a city department. We are a department of city government. All of our employees, including me, are employees of the city. And I like to tell people, and especially at budget time, that, you know, many of my colleagues in city government, street services and sanitation and public works and different departments like that, are not so fortunate to have the kind of volunteerism and philanthropic support that we do. And we feel very lucky about that. And so we are able to leverage public resources to go get more private resources. And also, I think it speaks well of the library that we're good stewards of philanthropic resources as well as public dollars as well. And you see here on this slide just many images of different friends groups, volunteers, supporters, outreach, and so forth. And at the library, I like to tell people, you know, a lot of people, when they speak about libraries and how libraries have changed, they say, oh, well, we're not your grandmother's library anymore. Well, actually, yes, we are. We're very much your grandmother's library, and we're proud to be your grandmother's library. We do all of the things that libraries did 50, 60, 70, 80, even 100 years ago. We have rich collections of books. We have over 6 million volumes at the LA Public Library, deep collections, wonderful collections. Our central library is very much a research library as well as a popular library. We have special collections, rare books. We have story time for children. We have, you know, children's activities, reading areas, places for quiet study. All of those things that you imagine a public library provides, we provide it. But we also take this very broad and expansive approach to literacy and lifelong learning. And we call ourselves, as most public libraries do, a lifelong learning institution. And that means that we are providing learning opportunities, not only through books, but programs and activities for every age. And as you'll see in my slides ahead, we really mean all ages, from infants to older adults. And so this gives you some example of the space that we work within here at the library. Family literacy, encouraging families to read together, talking to parents about the importance of reading together at home and reading to children. Financial literacy, programs around basic money management, savings accounts, checking accounts, mortgages, student loans, things like that. You know, the more young people know about money and money management, the better. And so we have a lot of programming around that. Health literacy, not only active programs that talk about various health issues in our branch libraries and central library, but also providing authoritative, accurate health information. The library can be a place to come and research a diagnosis, learn more about a particular health issue. And we also have health partnerships with health organizations, community health clinics to do blood pressure screenings at libraries. We have partnerships with Vision to Learn, which brings their vision van and provides free eye exams and eyeglasses to families. So leveraging the library and the fact that we are throughout LA and we have a physical presence in neighborhoods, looking at what the needs are in those neighborhoods and entering into partnerships to be able to provide those health resources is important. LA is a city of immigrants, so immigration literacy and providing immigration services. We have New Americans Welcome Stations in all 73 of our libraries. We have New American Centers, physical spaces where people can get one-on-one immigration assistance at 7 of our libraries. We actually contract with organizations that provide immigration services so that they can do that within those immigration centers. And this is so strategically valuable for the library because when we are a place where people can come and take their first step on the path to citizenship, get materials on how to take the citizenship test, get information on DACA or some other immigration issue, they are often exposed to the tradition of free public library service here in the United States. They learn that the library collects materials in their native language, the language they speak at home, that we have staff that speak those languages. They learn that a library card is free, that we are a place for them. And so that helps us accomplish our mission of serving absolutely everyone in LA and reminding people that we are here for everyone. Adult literacy, lifelong learning, teaching adults basic literacy skills, helping people prepare for the GED. I'll talk in a little bit about our online high school that we have. STEAM education, an acronym that stands for science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. Multilingual literacy. So just what I was speaking about earlier and all the different languages that we communicate in here at the library, and cultural literacy, actively celebrating the cultures that are here in Los Angeles. And I'll talk about those in a moment as well. Let's see. So one of the programs that is very exciting that I love talking about is Read Baby Read. And this is for the youngest Angelenos. It is so important that young families know how important it is to read to their infants. And that is the message of this program. It is provided by the library. We receive some external funding for this program. And essentially it provides a kit to young families with the baby's first book, their first library card, a little t-shirt that, as you can see, says Little Bookworm, or it says Read to Me on it. It includes branded materials, a sippy cup and other things, and also materials on how important it is to read to your child for their literacy development and to develop a lifelong love of reading and to build those literacy skills at the earliest possible stage. And this program carries that message. And also we're establishing a relationship with young families, and that's critical as well. And it makes for the best photos. I mean, is there anything better than seeing young babies in a library and being read to? And some of these images are from the launch of this program, which was so exciting. Students and being there for students is so important. School libraries are, and for years have suffered in the state of California. And so many schools either don't have libraries, they don't have staffed libraries, adequately staffed libraries. And so the public library's role is even that much more important. And so one of the things we did a few years ago was establish the student success card. And the Student Success Card is a really began as a partnership with the Los Angeles Unified School District to say, we don't want to just wait for families to come into the library to get a library card. We want to automatically ensure that every child in our public school system has a library card. So we created this program where we automatically issue cards before, just automatically, rather than waiting for people to fill out a form. And this ensures that they have access to all of our online eBooks, all of our digital resources, but also they can immediately come into the library and have access to everything that we have. This program was instituted before the pandemic, and you can imagine how essential having this in place was as the pandemic began, as students were at home, not able to access resources from their schools or for even coming into physical libraries until we began providing access to our collections through Library to Go and then opened our doors again. This allowed them automatic access to all of those online resources, and it was huge. So making certain that we reach students in every way possible is a priority of the library. Digital literacy is also just a huge area in which libraries have been engaged in for decades now. Beginning in the late 80s, early 90s, libraries began providing internet access to communities. So, you know, the basics of that are that all of our libraries have computers with internet access that anyone in the community can come in and have access to. This is so important everywhere, but particularly important in poor communities where people can't afford internet access at home, they can't afford computers. The library has been doing this for 30 years. The pandemic shined a very bright light on digital equity, digital access, digital literacy. People realized the importance of this because during the pandemic, that was their connection to everything. And so it's wonderful to see that. It is still a big issue in this country. But public libraries have been doing good work in this space, like I said, for 30 plus years. So hopefully there will be more attention focused on this, and that as a nation, we will see broadband access, internet access as something as almost as important as water and electricity. It is required to be and to be a citizen and to participate in society these days. We also teach digital literacy skills, how to use our online resources. The LA Public Library invests heavily in these resources, and we want people to know how to use them. No public library in the United States circulates more eBooks and e-audiobooks than the LA Public Library. LA is a city of readers, and they show that every day with heavy, heavy use of our online resources. We also provide access to online courses, research databases, and also new technologies with maker spaces in our libraries as well. So there's a lot we do in this space. Two really exciting and forward-thinking examples of how we provide, you know, digital access and access to new and emerging technologies is the Octavia Lab here at Central Library and the Koreatown Media Lab. These are two sort of high-tech labs and creative digital spaces, if you will, at two of our libraries. They have podcasting studios, 3D printing, digital embroidery, laser cutters, photography studio, and staff to show people how to use this technology. This is so important because young people don't have access to this often in their own neighborhoods and certainly not at home. And to be able to provide access to this free in a library is absolutely critical. And how exciting that it's happening in a public library. And so we're really, really, really proud of this. We do this through staff of the library, and also we fund some of the technology acquisitions through outside resources. If you haven't been to these spaces, please come. Our staff is amazing, and these spaces are very, 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 very busy. Another area of digital literacy is Tech to Go. This is where we received some substantial funding during the pandemic and have continued to invest in it, where we are essentially circulating technology just like we would a book. So we're checking out a laptop, we're checking out a mobile Wi-Fi hotspot so people can have a laptop at home and access to the internet at home. And that's being provided free of charge. Now, the number of these devices that we have to check out is limited, but when someone has internet access at home, it's not just being used by one person, it's being used by the entire household, which is just incredibly exciting and important, and bridging the digital divide. Now, we can provide all of this, all of these ebooks and downloadable audiobooks, all of this access to this online content, online courses. But if people don't have the skills to be able to use that technology, then it's for naught. So being able to show people how to use it is so important. And so we have a number of these tech tryout carts, which is essentially a cart with a variety of technology. So we might have a Kindle, another kind of ebook reader, a laptop, a phone, to show people how to download the app, to show people how to use all of these online resources that we provide. And you'll sometimes see these folks in our libraries, see them here at Central Library, showing folks how to access our online music, the movies that you can download from the library for free, and all of the ebook resources that we provide. So that's tech tryout carts. And then tech kiosks. So in some of our libraries, we're often limited in space, or we have such huge demand for computers and internet access that having fixed computers with furniture simply isn't going to meet that demand. And so we have a tech kiosk, which is essentially a vending machine where all you need is your library card, and we check out a laptop to you or an iPad for use in the library to take advantage of the fact that we have Wi-Fi in our library. And by the way, all of our libraries have Wi-Fi access. And being able to provide this is really an essential service. So the library, as you know, I hope, we are very much caretakers and preservers and collectors of LA history. We have, if any of you remember the old Herald Examiner newspaper, or I know many of you are in the San Fernando Valley, if you remember the Valley Times newspaper, these are newspapers that had huge photographic archives. Well, guess what? We have, and we're the recipient of those photographic archives. And so here at Central Library, we have over 3.5 million photographic images in our collection. We have a digitization lab, and we actively are digitizing those images and all of the information associated with those images. So if we have a photograph of the a League of Women Voters gathering from 1977 in Reseda, and who was in that image and what the date was and where it was and what building it was in, that image and all of the information is here at the library. And we are slowly but surely digitizing all of that content. We're up to about 200,000, a little over 200,000 images. And the beautiful thing is that these images can be searched online. So if you're looking for a picture of Wilshire Boulevard in the 1970s, or the picture of a branch bank in Porter Ranch, or what have you, you can search for it. And the place to do that is TESSA, T-S-S-A. That is where you can find the digital collections of the library. And in addition to photographs, we have digitized a number of our restaurant menus. The library has over 17,000 restaurant menus, not all from Southern California, but most of them are. And you can search for that in TESSA. And you just need to Google TESSA Library or look at lapl.org/TESSA. Very easy to find. It's a beautiful site. And it's frankly just fun to just browse. You don't even have to be looking for anything in particular. Just browsing it is very exciting. And you see on the screen here under photo collection, that's an image of Angel's Flight, the funicular in downtown LA, where we have many historic images as well as newer ones as well. TESSA, by the way, was the first name of one of my predecessors, a city librarian who was here in this role over 100 years ago. And we chose to name the site for her. So I talked about health literacy. Here are some examples of some of those programs where we do blood pressure screenings. We have a resource fair for veterans, the Vision to Learn program where we provide free eyeglasses. You see, that's me down there with some kids that took advantage of that. We also provide health resources for the unhoused here at Central Library, one day a month, and other resources as well. And so a dental clinic you see there up top, that's another service we provide. So that's very, very important. New Americans Initiative, these are some images up top from a citizenship ceremony that we had. I mentioned the welcome stations earlier. You see one of those where it says New Americans Initiative below with some individuals with kits that have materials on how best to take the citizenship exam with flashcards and other resources like that. And then off to the left there with the sort of turquoise colored wall, someone providing one-on-one assistance in one of our New American centers. I mentioned adult literacy earlier and helping people learn to read, improve math skills, adults who need that literacy assistance. We also do English language conversation classes, but we also, in addition to traditional literacy services, we also have something called Career Online High School. And this is an online program for adults who are 19 years and older and who did not get their high school diploma for whatever reason. Maybe they were caring for an ill parent. Maybe they had to work to support a family or some other reason. And they don't have that high school diploma, nor do they have a GED, and they would prefer the diploma over the GED. This high school program will allow them to do that. And every story of every graduate is a magical, wonderful, frankly, emotional story. And it's such a successful program. You see a graduation ceremony here at Central Library in the bottom middle photo, where we had a graduating class. We do two of these graduation ceremonies a year. And to date, we've had over 950 people get their high school diploma through the LA Public Library. How fabulous is that? How powerful is that? Life-changing. These are individuals that can now get a promotion at a job, get a better job, get a job, go on to two-year school, technical school, go on even to four-year school. So really, really powerful, powerful program. I mentioned how important literacy access is. These are individuals who are library staff members and members of our translations team. They are translating press releases, flyers, advertising programs, and other communications here at the library on an ongoing basis to make certain that language is not a barrier to people learning about what the library provides. So just enormously important. And I will tell you, during the pandemic, these individuals were providing such important service, not only within the library, but they were helping to translate communications that the city was sending out to communities about various matters as it related to COVID-19. So real fantastic people, fantastic staff who are doing so much to provide a greater access to library resources. Cultural literacy, celebrating all of the amazing cultures here in Los Angeles. You see examples of those cultural celebrations on the screen. Some of those I'll just highlight real quickly. Nowruz, which is Persian New Year. We have celebrated that in Western LA, Encino, Tarzana, Westwood areas. This year, we celebrated it for the first time here at Central Library back in March, but a wonderful way to celebrate Persian culture, the Farsi language, really a successful celebration. Lunar New Year is something that we celebrate an event that is celebrated in many Asian cultures with dancing, musical performances, and so forth. We also are celebrating Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month now in May. And this Saturday from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. here at Central Library, we will have the AAPI Joy Festival, which will be a celebration of many, many Asian cultures. And of course, here in Los Angeles, we have so many vibrant, wonderful, active Asian cultures here. And it will be a day that will take up all corners of Central Library. So here at Central Library this Saturday, 11 to 4, please check that out. June Jubilee is coming up on June 8th here in Central Library as well. We would love to be able to have all of these programs at many of our branches, and our branches do celebrate, have cultural celebrations, but these that I'm highlighting now are big, multi-dimensional cultural celebrations that out of necessity have to happen here at Central Library. But June Jubilee is one where it's a celebration of Black excellence in the arts, genealogy, music, film, engineering, a variety of different areas. And we do that in many ways here at Central Library. We did the first June Jubilee last year. This year we'll be doing it again. And of course it nicely is close to Juneteenth, which is now a holiday. So a wonderful way to draw attention to Juneteenth and also celebrate the African-American community here in Los Angeles. The LA Libros Festival is a Spanish language and also bilingual English-Spanish book festival here at Central Library that happens in the fall. Please look for it. Everyone is welcome. We have authors of children's books, story time programs, arts programs, craft programs, music. It is a celebration that we've done for many years now. Thousands come. It's for everyone. Please check that out. A really important thing for the library to do to serve LA's very large Spanish-speaking population and those who want to know Spanish and learn. Full Steam Ahead is an initiative focused primarily on children and teens, but really can serve all ages. And this is recognizing that science, technology, engineering, and arts and math education is oh so important, and that infusing those that learning in young people is very, very, very important. This also addresses a disparity, a gender disparity, where girls and women are underrepresented in science and technology fields. And so being able to teach, celebrate, and present these kinds of programs and how fabulous and interesting they are to young people is certainly addressing that. And participation in these programs is very gender diverse and diverse across the board. So we have maker fairs, we have individual programs and branch libraries that serve all ages. We even have toddler programs on science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. So really, really, really terrific. And our staff love it, and they are very talented at being able to provide these programs. I mentioned that we have the Central Library, 72 branch libraries across the city. They are absolutely wonderful, and great things happen within the four walls of our libraries. However, it is important that we take the library out into the community, that we do outreach, that we go out into the community and register people for library cards, that we tell people about all of the great work that we do. And so we do this through a variety of ways. We have outreach librarians that go into schools, that go into senior centers, that go to festivals and set up tents and tables at various cultural festivals, neighborhood gatherings, to talk about the work of the library. We also have this wonderful fleet of street fleet vehicles that can take technology and craft programs and things out into the community. Think of it as sort of a modern day bookmobile, if you will. We also have the very old school book bikes, where the brilliant Anita Kelly, one of our children's librarians, who is actually on the bike in the upper right hand corner, had the idea to say, let's acquire a cart with a big box on it, sort of like an ice cream cart, if you will. But instead of ice cream, let's have books in it and give books away and also sign people up for library cards. And that is exactly what we do. And you see on the left-hand side, big library card, which we take everywhere. And we'd love to take photos of people with the library card, but also just books that we can just give away, because people having books in their home library is important as well. And then we hope they come into the library and check lots of books out as well. So community engagement, outreach, going, being in parades, letting people know that the public library is there for them is enormously important. The library card, I've talked about it a lot, so important, and we do all that we can to promote it. We have a wonderful public relations and marketing team. We will put the library card in the hands of everyone, and we love taking pictures of celebrities with the library card. So we were lucky enough to get Keanu Reeves there in the upper left-hand corner to hold the library card. Civil rights icon, pioneer, Dolores Huerta there in the lower left. Emilio Estevez, Clifford the Big Red Dog. We love promoting the library card on social media and letting people know how important that is. Now, I also just want to mention this critical issue of the banned books, book banning across the country, and just mention that this is a real crisis, I think, for libraries and for communities across the country. The American Library Association, which is our professional association, documented 4,240 unique book titles targeted for censorship in 2023. In public libraries, the number of titles challenged in 2023 increased significantly, you can see, over the previous year. We celebrate banned books and the access to books that have been challenged. And sometimes that's everything from, Toni Morrison's Beloved to The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn to Tom Sawyer and other books that we think of as classics that still get challenged. We use this week as an opportunity to remind people about libraries' commitment and librarians' commitment to intellectual freedom and the ability to read whatever you want. We do have that commitment to intellectual freedom. And just going back to the number of books that have been challenged across the country, and so many challenges do result in ultimate book bans and books being removed from library collections. Most of those that have been challenged are books by and about people of color or about the LGBTQ community. So a real concern across the country. One of the ways in which the library addresses this and speaks to this, and I will say this is not at the moment a huge issue here in Los Angeles in terms of us having materials challenged that we put on the shelves. That said, it is something that I encourage all Angelenos to be vigilant about, because I think this is something that affects public libraries as an institution across the country. And I have colleagues that are no longer in their jobs because of this issue in various places. So one of the ways that the library has dealt with this is the program that we have that's called Read Freely at the Los Angeles Public Library. And we are simply providing free and easy access to books, the books that have been most challenged and banned on that list that the American Library Association collects, and to be able to provide them to anyone in the country. So you do not have to live within LA or California to have access to that. We are simply providing open access. And of course, when the library provides eBooks, we are purchasing access to that. That is not something that's just magically free. Just as we have to buy a physical book to put up on the shelf, for our patrons, we also are buying access to an ebook. So this is making that available to everyone. And so if you are in a community where a particular book is banned, you perhaps may be able to find it if it's one of the most banned books at the Los Angeles Public Library through Read Freely, demonstrating our commitment to the freedom to read. And with that, I thank you so much for listening. I hope we can have time for questions and answers. I love this image. It is a young patron, one of our youngest, sitting in the book bike. And she has received a book that I trust she's taken home and read. And at this point, this photo is a few years old, so I trust she's older and checking lots of books out from the LA Public Library. And this photo is often a reminder to me of why I do what I do and why I love being a librarian and why I love being your city librarian here at the LA Public Library. So with that, I'll stop sharing my presentation, and I look forward to any questions that you all have.
Oh, thank you so much. We have a couple of questions already. Someone was asking if there is a link between books that the library provides to the free little libraries that you see around the city sometimes. So I'll ask that one first.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of people that are users of libraries that, in an effort to provide more access to free books, have put up free libraries in their neighborhoods and make access. Those are not things that the library operates, but I imagine that many of the books that might be donated to our library might find their way to these little free libraries where people can take them. take them home and then bring back another book. Anything that gets people reading is fantastic. And I know that there are more formal relationships between public libraries and little free libraries elsewhere in the country.
Okay, and we have a question about asking if you could please talk a little bit more about the digital education and skills tools that are available.
Yes, the library provides access to dozens and dozens and dozens of online courses that can be everything from how to be a better public speaker or how to, you know, repair an engine to how to use a word processing program. So many, many, many online programs, also lots of in-person programs as well. We also offer classes in things like genealogy, classes in how to make use of the various research databases that the library provides. If you go to lapl.org, you'll see under resources, you'll see an A to Z list of databases and resources. It is so lengthy. Some of them more research-oriented databases, others databases of more popular material and articles and things like that. There are just so many resources like that that are available. And those online classes sometimes come with certificates and things like that. So again, lifelong learning happens in informal ways, but also formal ways at the library. And we're always happy to help folks access any of those resources, help them navigate all of our online presence, because our website can be very daunting. There's so much there. We want to be able to help people. And even when that means working one-on-one with them to help navigate and find exactly what it is they're looking for.
Do you have any specific programs about telling people about how they should vote or what voting access is available?
Yeah, we're not telling people how to vote, but we certainly...
I just meant not who to vote for, but voting rules and regulation.
Absolutely. We are always delighted to provide, you know, nonpartisan information, how to access information online. One thing notably that I'm really proud of is a number of our libraries serve as in-person voting locations, but also early in the pandemic, and maybe even it was prior to the pandemic, we were asked by the LA County Registrar to provide a vote by mail drop boxes at our libraries. And we were initially asked, I want to say, to provide, you know, those at 12 or so of our locations. And I remember saying, well, only 12, you know, and thinking that we would be hesitant or it would be a big lift or what have you. And I think then they came back and said, well, how about 19? And I said, well, sure, but do you want more? And anyway, ultimately, we have them at every single one of our locations. And I absolutely love that. And my only ask of them to do this, and we worked with each branch manager to put it at the best spot, you know, the most accessible spot with the registrar at each location, and to provide them to make certain that they were secure at a secure spot. But my only ask was, can you tell me in aggregate among all 73 drop boxes, how many votes were dropped off? And I'm really pleased to say that the first general election, which was 2020, where those boxes were all in place, over 400,000 ballots were dropped at the locations of the Los Angeles Public Library. So that is another way that we participate in being sort of good participants in civic life. And, you know, folks will call us and ask us about access. So we're answering questions about that as well. We're also promoting through social media and other means the fact that we have those drop boxes. And of course, the registrar and other folks are saying, oh, all LA Public Library locations have those drop boxes. So that's an important thing.
I just wanted to add that I, in fact, I'm one of the 400,000 that have used your LA
wonderful
drop boxes for voting. Also, they had a question about for the LA library. I think many of us really didn't expect that Los Angeles would have too many challenges to ban books. And in fact, we would like to know, has that been an issue at all for the LA library?
No, it hasn't. I will say that almost all libraries have a process in place for our patrons to express a concern about a book, if they think that the book should be in a different area of our collection, or, you know, it does give them the ability to say that they think the book should not be in the collection. We've had a handful of those over the years. My experience in libraries, and this is the fifth public library I've directed, you know, I was previously head of libraries in Atlanta, and before that I was in Florida for a bit, is often when and not all the time, but often when folks challenge a book or ask that a book be removed, often they've not read the book, or it is part of a larger effort to challenge books, and an organization or something like that has encouraged them to do that. And so most libraries that have a process in place generally ask for a lot of specifics about what it is about the book that bothers them. But no, we really haven't. And often, you know, a conversation with a patron, you know, if it will often help the situation. That said, there are organized movements across the country to limit all books about a particular subject within a library's collections. And that's really concerning, you know, and there are books at the LA Public Library that are on our shelves that have content in them that would deeply offend me and upset me. But that doesn't mean that I am taking them off the shelf and don't want them in our collection. I will fight to have them on the shelf and make them available for other people. And just because you don't want that book for your family doesn't mean that it should be restricted or kept from others. And that's a concept most people get and understand, but it's an important thing to remind folks of that sort of value of providing materials that represent a variety of viewpoints in libraries. And it's sort of core to who we are.
I'm going to interject for a moment. Sorry, Anne.
Sure.
I think maybe some of our folks who aren't able to type into the chat would like to ask a question. Joyce, I see you've unmuted yourself. Do you have a question for our guest?
Well, yes. I'm not sure this is the question for somebody so well-versed in libraries, but I've noticed that, unfortunately, some libraries are being used for purposes other than just books, and that there are some people who will go into a library first thing in the morning to wash up, to have a place to come in out of the sun or out of the rain because they have no other places to go. And so they pick the library, which is, of course, always open. And I'm wondering what kind of policy you have with respect to the people who use the library for other purposes than what they're supposed to be used for.
That's a very good question and totally appropriate question to ask me, and one that I frankly get asked a lot. You know, the issue of libraries being used in that manner, and specifically the point of intersection between the issue that small cities as well as large ones face, the issue of homelessness, is one that you know, is been connect libraries and homelessness have been connected for a long time. We've been used in that way. I think that today the crisis that we're seeing in LA and the growth in the issue of homelessness is bringing that issue more to the forefront. One of the things I like to say about that issue is that, does it impact the library? It absolutely does. Does it pose tremendous challenges to us? Absolutely. But as long as individuals, whether they are multimillionaires and live in big houses and are using the library, or whether they do not have homes and are living in a tent on the street, so long as they're abiding by our basic rules and code of conduct, they are welcome. They are treated with respect. You know, they're welcome to use our facilities. But it you know, often homelessness is accompanied by mental illness. It's accompanied by a variety of other issues. The need to use the library in ways that might not be part of sort of what we think of as the core services that we provide. And also, some people can find that, you know, intimidating seeing people, you know, using the library in that way. And so it is an issue. But one of the things I'm so proud of about libraries generally, and I'm really proud of about the LA Public Library, is that we don't just say, oh, we're reacting to this issue and we're putting in place things that help us deal with the issue, but rather we're stepping forward into the issue and we're saying, well, you know, if we have homeless individuals and people in crisis making use of our libraries, is there something that we can do? Is there a way that we can be proactive to be able to help with the issue and help the leaders of LA address the issue while also ensuring that the library is a safe, secure, and welcoming place for absolutely everybody in the community? And, you know, we do that through a variety of ways. We now have social workers on staff, if you can believe it. We're providing, working with local agencies and nonprofits to provide mental health services. We're providing hygiene kits in some instances. We're training our staff in de-escalation, helping them to de-escalate situations where someone might be having a mental health episode in our libraries. Over 500 of our staff are trained in the administration of Narcan, which is a nasally administered drug to reverse an opioid overdose. Can you believe your city librarian is bragging about the fact that over 500 of his staff are trained to do that? It is a sad state of affairs in our country and in our city that that has to be the case. But we've also saved 7 lives, and I'm proud that that we're able to actually deal with the issue in that way. Our libraries are safe spaces. We do deal with incidents and issues. So we have an LAPD presence in a number of our libraries and also contract security in many of our libraries to help us deal with issues as they come up. But when you are a public institution and you spread your institutional arms like this every morning, welcoming everyone in, all of the issues that the city faces are going to come into those in the doors as well. And we just have to have the resources and the nimbleness to respond to it, to not only make certain we're a safe space for those folks in crisis and all, but also that mom with stroller and an older adult who wants to come in and attend a program, or someone else wants to come in and use our resources to see an exhibit, to come to a musical program, to take advantage of all those resources I talked about in my presentation. We want that to be able to happen, and we want to be able to provide that environment. So it's a long answer, but it is a challenge, but I'm proud of the way in which we address it. And at the end of the day, everyone is welcome at the library so long as they abide by the basic and reasonable rules of the library.
Fantastic. Well, we've only got a couple more minutes for questions. So if you've already asked a question, stop unmuting yourself, because we have a queue of people with their hands raised. If our guests will indulge us for a little bit more, unless you're asked to unmute, don't. And I'm going to call on Sharon, would you go ahead and ask your question, please?
My question is about the rumor I have heard about the hot off the press status. The program is very popular at our branch, and the rumor is that the program will be canceled.
I can't imagine why we would do that. It's not a funding issue. We're actually putting more money toward collections and services. So I am not aware of that ending. Are you from Platt by chance?
Yes.
I know you. You're a wonderful supporter of the library. Thank you. sorry for that. I had to get that out there. No, I am not aware of that. And our commitment to provide popular titles through that program remains there. I don't know what that rumor is about, whether it's a name change or something, but no, we actually are investing more in collections and materials. So I'm happy to, I'll mention that and ask that, but I'm not aware of that rumor, and I'm not aware of us doing that.
Okay, so again, unless I've asked you to unmute, do not unmute yourself. I'm gonna call on Susan next, please. Go ahead and ask your question.
Yes, I just wanted to make a statement. I love that the libraries are used as cooling centers especially in communities where it's really hot and many people do not have access to home cooling. And thank you.
Thank you for saying that. We're proud to do that, and it's a good way in which we can help in those times.
Hang on a second, unless I've asked you to unmute, do not unmute. We've got a queue of people waiting to ask a question. Laura Mitchell, please go ahead.
Mute myself. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I was wondering to what extent the library's materials and programs have been made certain to be accessible to people with a variety of disabilities, blindness, hearing problems, physical access. Just out of curiosity, I know there are some materials, for example, books that are available as audio books or as digital books, but not all of them are. And just wondering to what extent the library has put effort into making sure that the services are accessible to people with disabilities.
That's a great question. A significant effort and thinking about what barriers there might be to certain collections and how we can improve access, whether it's through a new format or what have you. We do provide, as you mentioned, audiobooks, but also with digital books where it can improve access for visually impaired individuals by adjusting font size and things like that. Also expanding purchases and collections of large print material for our physical collections, making certain that all of our online resources are accessible, that our website is accessible, providing more materials and instructions, not only in text, but in video as well. We also work very closely with the Department on Disability to ensure that we are meeting all of the basic requirements, but that we're also going a step beyond. So the library, for example, will have a presence at and at gatherings like Deaf Fest for deaf and the hard of hearing community, and also helping folks who might have more severe visual impairments connect with the Braille Institute and Library of Congress, Braille materials and the library materials for the visually impaired that they might have access to there. And then we also have a variety of special collections for parents who have children with disabilities or learning disabilities, programs for the neurodivergent and other activities like that. And of course, also just making certain that people are aware that they can have sign language interpretation and things like that at public programs and all. And then we also have collections that are like descriptive videos where someone can check out a film where everything that's happening in the film is being described, things like that to ensure access.
Well, that's wonderful. And we are at time. I'm going to invite one of our committee members, Joyce Batten, to help lead us out of this very wonderful presentation. Joyce?
Oh, I must have missed the last few minutes on my computer. Are we at the end of the Q&A?
Yes, we are.
Yes.
Well, this is our opportunity to say thank you so much for taking the time and opportunity to speak to us today. I think we learned a lot, and we really appreciate some of the issues that you've discussed and what you're doing about them. So thank you again for taking the time to talk to us today.
My pleasure. Thank you so much. It was wonderful. Thank you for all your questions as well.
I should say one additional thing. We do, our unit, our San Fernando Valley unit, happens to have a book club. And the chair of our book club is with us today. Sue, are you there? Would you like to say hello? Sue?
Yes, I would love to, but am I muted?
There's our book club chair.
Well, thank you. Yes, our July book is our July meeting, we'll spend the first few minutes discussing Empress of the Nile, since we weren't able to do it this month. And then Neil Mitchell will lead the discussion on the alternative history book that he loves called The Other Time by Mac Reynolds. I hope you can access the book. I tried to get it through the LAPL site and wasn't quite successful.
Oh, we can help with that. We certainly would love to.
Thank you. The only thing I saw was an ebook, and which is great for Laura, but what I was looking for was I want a hard copy that I can put a hold on. And it's an old book, John, called The Other Time by Mac Reynolds. Neil, are you on this?